Hello and welcome to Research 101, a new webinar series where we'll take a ride down the how-to highway with subject matter experts to learn tips and tricks that will help take your research farther and faster. My name is Enrica Ziller, Research Education Programs and Outreach Manager in the Office of Research at the University of Texas at Dallas. I will be your moderator. As we move through today's session, please post your questions at any time to the chat for our guest speakers to address. With us today is Dr. Mario Retea, Eric Johnson Chair in Engineering and Computer Science, Department Head of Mechanical Engineering, and Director of the Center for Wind Energy. I am also delighted to introduce Dr. Bhavani Thurasingham, the Founders Chair Professor of Computer Science and Executive Director of the Cybersecurity Research and Education Institute. Both Retea and Thurasingham have wisdom to share from their experiences as former program officers, and together with the Associate Director of Office of Sponsored Programs Administration, Emily Lacey, they will discuss why getting to know program officers is an excellent investment of your time and suggest some best practices for engagement. Dr. Retea, will you start things off?
Thank you, Enrica. Good morning, everyone, or good afternoon, whichever it is for you. It's a real pleasure to do these things. My experience is primarily with the National Science Foundation because I did a term as a program director in the Directorate of Engineering. And then I was a division director in the same directorate in engineering education and centers. So total experience with NSF as an administrator and in these roles is about 4 years, but I've known NSF for a while through the same thing that interests you today, which is getting funding. And what I did is I don't have slides. I just have a bunch of talking points. And my plan is to, you will see my eyes veering away from either the camera or the main screen because my talking points are on the left of my screen. So I wanted to warn you that that's what I'm looking at. I'm not watching TV while I'm talking to you. Let me start with the National Science Foundation. I think all of you know what this agency stands for. It is probably somewhere around $9 billion worth of research and other activities. And I think it's a phenomenal organization because peer review is what drives the outcome. Is it perfect? No. But does it work as a process? Yes. I think if you're trying to get funding, the activities that you need to do are clear. And you need to know the purpose of the agency. And in this case, NSF has more than one, but in the context of research proposals, I think that the vast majority of you, and I don't know who is on the other side of my screen or camera, vast majority of you are interested in research proposals. And that essentially for the National Science Foundation is curiosity-driven research to advance knowledge for the well-being of our society is what NSF calls transformative research. There is no mission. I mean, NSF doesn't have the mission to create energy systems or to create drones or to help with drug discovery. NSF funds curiosity-driven research organized by its directorates and then the divisions and then the programs. So that takes me to the next thing that you need to know very well. After knowing the purpose, know the agency. The website of NSF is extremely good. It has everything you need to know. You really don't need to attend too many talks if you know how to navigate that website. NSF has at the very top, the office of the director, and then under the director, there are a number of directorates. Each directorate has an assistant director. And then, and in each directorate, and the one that is more relevant to me is, excuse me, ENG, engineering, has a number of divisions. like civil and mechanical and manufacturing innovation, CBET, which is chemical, bio, and something else that I don't remember. I know them by acronym, and so on. And under the divisions are the programs. So what's the most important part that you need to know in order to increase your chances of funding is know the program. You need to get to know the program directors, and we'll talk a little bit more about that. But you don't have to worry too much about the directorate or the division or the overall foundation, because at that level, the programs are consolidated under these big buckets, and it's difficult to learn what it is that you need to do to satisfy the interest of a particular program director. What happens at the level of directorates are solicitations, and that cross-cutting across different directorates and sometimes across different divisions. So that's something that could be important to know if you are looking to do some team science, and we can talk about that later. So know the purpose, know the agency, then know the review criteria. It's written, it's very clean, it's intellectual merit and broader impacts. The intellectual merit is these are broad statements. You really are trying to excite the mind of a reviewer in terms of, okay, there is some degree of novelty in what I want to do. It has not been done before, and I have the right skill set to address this problem. And broader impact is something that we can talk in the later session, because I want to really focus on intellectual merit. I think that's the main driver for someone that wants to break the ice with funding from a specific program. So you know the review criteria, then what's the process? How is this review criteria being executed? It's peer review. It's either with a panel or a combination of panelists and ad hoc reviews. So this is the group that needs to know you, and I'll talk about this later in my talking points. So now you have purpose, agency, criteria, process. What's next? Well, in reality, this is the very first objective. What's your goal? What problem are you trying to solve? And if you really understand the problem you want to solve, you need to formulate a research question to address it. What research question you seek to answer? It cannot be, I want to do X, Y, and C, because if I do X, Y, and C, I will get X. No, the research question goes first, the methods come later. And then is the so what? Okay, if you achieve your objective, if your research question gets an answer in the positive, if you test the hypothesis and validates your thesis or conjecture, what will change? Who cares? So what? I mean, this needs to be understood. Sometimes that's difficult, but when it's difficult, it better be very innovative. Because if it is not something that is entirely new and we have no idea how to do it, then the chances are that unless you justify the so what, the program director may not pull the trigger, so to speak. So you have your goal, then you need to understand the state of the art, what has been accomplished relative to your research question today, and then a plan to move from where things are today to where things need to be in the future when you reach your goal or answer the research question. An important thing about the plan is you cannot just be a newcomer. Preliminary work counts. I think it's very unlikely that someone that doesn't have any paper in the area, and any paper in a good journal in the area that or whatever venue measures goodness in your own field, it's very unlikely that unless there is a record of that, you will get funding. I mean, people need to have some track record in order to aspire to doing this. And that's why at the beginning of anyone's career, it's probably a good idea to, okay, first couple of years under my PhD, I'm going to focus on establishing my identity, or at least getting the first couple of initials of my full name, so to speak, known in my research community. And then I would start writing proposals. The reason why I insist on this is establishing identities, because you don't want to, you know, we all fail. That's okay. Failure is a mechanism to learn. Without an error signal, we don't know how to do a correction. But we don't want to have too many failures with proposals. We don't want to be sending the same thing all over again. It's better to wait until you are ready to submit with good chances of getting funding. Of course, this is an organization that has outstanding information systems, and your proposal goes through a compliance checking process that calculates margins and whatever. So you have to read the PAPPG, that's the proposal guide, the proposal manual, proposal and award manual. I think the G stands for guideline, but that's what it is. It's a manual on how to write a proposal. Respect the format. Don't try to put more words. Don't try to reduce the font. I mean, I've seen proposals which are painful to read, very painful. So, and that, you know, that will put the reviewer in the wrong spot. Your job is to have to facilitate the job of the reviewer. Big font, good graphics, less words, less is more. And it's not easy, I know that, because as it has been said, if I had more time, I'll write you a shorter letter. The same thing happens with the proposal. Make your key points and move on. Then, you know, spend time on writing the proposal. Don't get disrupted by other things. I don't think multitasking helps when one wants to write a successful proposal. You have to embed yourself and do it. Maybe it works for some, it certainly doesn't work for me. Well, what I just said is known to everybody, but what's the secret sauce? There is none. This is a very transparent process, but there are some things you can do to be more competitive. So as I said earlier, you got to find a program that matches your research, and you need to disseminate your work. I mean, quantity does not matter, but quality does. Why would you publish two papers when you can do just one? What counts is impact, getting your name out and as a contributor to an area with impact. Again, give seminars, get invited to give seminars, not everywhere, but in certain places, and you know your field. Meet your program directors. Almost all conferences organized by major professional societies, the ASME, the IEEE, and so on, they have sessions to meet one-on-one with program directors. Those meetings are 15, 20 minutes. They have to be very short, very clear. If you look at what is required to get invited to one of these meetings, there is a conference for mechanical engineering. They ask you name, 25-word description of your area, and what is important, a link to your website. Now, your website helps a lot, and this is something that I personally need to improve myself, but you, many of you are much younger than me and probably have done a much better job with website than what I have. But one thing that I want to tell you is that in your website, don't put absolutely everything. The theory of everything is useful for nothing. Be very clever on how you convey your message. Sometimes people try to put too much, and that's just noise. It doesn't get noticed. Be selective. Be selective. That's going to help you. All of this is for a single PI, maybe a couple of PIs working together. But in addition to this, there are opportunities for engaging in large teams, and those are the solicitations. And the solicitations are either for specific topics, and those topics are usually organized around some of the big ideas that NSF has. Right now there are 10 big ideas, and some of the topics actually involve other things as well. That requires that you interact with senior colleagues to see how your expertise can be used to give a competitive advantage to the team and participate on that. This is a good approach. I mean, I'm a senior faculty member and I suggest this because that's a way to get started. You can always differentiate yourself in a team by saying, okay, this is what I do, and if you take it out, you don't have the final result. So then your identity is not lost in a team. This solicitation also applies for larger activity centers. I run an industry university cooperative research center, and some of the faculty get funded there. So, you know, that's the way to break the ice, so to speak, and then eventually write your own proposals as a single PI or as a leader or collaborator in a large team. And with this, I'll stop.
Right. So I'm Bhavani Thuraisingam, and again, I'll provide some insights on interacting with program directors. So actually what Dr. Rotaya presented, what I'm going to present is going to complement what he presented. Okay, so a little bit about my background, general advice, and interacting with the National Science Foundation. And Dr. Rotaya went into a lot of details, so I'm just going to briefly discuss. And then I'll also talk about interacting with, say, the Department of Defense and the intelligence agencies, because I've got a lot of experience in doing that as well. And then some final thoughts. So before that, my background. So I worked in cybersecurity and data science since 1985 at Honeywell, so I had some industry experience. MITRE Corporation, a federal research lab. And then I was a program director at NSF and joined UT Dallas in fall 2004. So my program director experience was from 2001 to 2004 while I was at MITRE Corporation, the federal lab. And then while I was there, while I was at MITRE, I was a principal investigator for several projects funded by the Department of Defense Intelligence Community. And then I've continued with that at UT Dallas with lots of funding from the DoD and the intelligence community, in particular Army, Navy, Air Force, NSA, and CIA. And so the rest are not, you know, as sort of relevant, just some my, you know, accomplishments and so on. So let me move into some general advice, right? So first of all, as Dr. Rotaya mentioned, you've got to develop a very strong technical expertise in your field, right? You have to be known in your field, which is in a way hard because especially when you start out, right? So you just after your PhD, so you've got to build that expertise. But at the same time, I believe that you can't really not submit proposals. So you've got to start focusing on your, say, your NSF career proposal, but don't rush it. And as Dr. Rotaya mentioned, it has to be really good proposals, because you don't want to get a reputation of just submitting anything. Because once you have this bad reputation, then sometimes it's hard to erase that, right? So even if you don't get your proposal funded, at least if it's competitive or even low competitive and not funded, at least people have a good impression about you. So another thing he said is to understand all of the details about the funding agency, and I'll go specific into NSF and DoD. And you also have to understand the interests, research interests, and the responsibilities of the particular program director, right? When I was at NSF, I had different, each of the 3 years, I had different roles. The first year, I was the program director of information and data management, and that was more focusing what we call now data science. The second year was mainly I focused on ITR, the information technology research, in particular the information management part, and I also had started a small program, data and application security. And the third year, I was focusing on cyber trust, which now has evolved into what they call the SETC program, the cybersecurity program. Another thing is you've got to read the call for proposals, right? You shouldn't be just sort of skimming it through. Really understand, because every word matters. And then you'd like to talk to the program director, right? So that's sort of the challenging part, because some of them are very responsive. Remember, they have got what, 50, 60, 70, 80 PIs. And some of them may not be. So you've got to find out a way. Sometimes even if they don't respond, if there's another program director that sort of you can maybe talk to, so to get some advice how to get, you know, to get a meeting with this program director. But again, you don't want to annoy the program director to go to someone else. But anyway, so that is important. Set up an appointment and to discuss with the program director. And before you go and start just talking, right, without planning, you have to rehearse what you're going to say. And also you've got to learn to speak effectively and communicate your ideas. And something I find some PIs or potential PIs, they don't listen to the comments because they are so involved or interested in what they want to say. They don't sort of listen to what you have to say as a program director. And don't get discouraged if the comments are not positive, right? But sure to follow up. And another thing that you can do is sort of see whether you can organize some workshops in your field. You can get some funding, $20,000 to organize some workshops. So these are all some very useful things, some general advice. Okay, so now we are talking about the National Science Foundation, and Dr. Rotea gave an excellent, some excellent information what to do. So mine is sort of more general, but it complements what he has said. Be thorough with the topic, right? And make sure the science is clear, regardless of whether it's engineering, physics, natural sciences, mathematics, social sciences, and I am in computer science. So make sure what are the fundamental ideas. As Dr. Rotea says, NSF funds, you know, not sort of mission-oriented research, but sort of breakthrough ideas, right? Intellectual merit and broader impact, they are very crucial. And more, sort of recently, there's more and more emphasis on broader impact. Of course, intellectual merit goes without saying, right? The technical excellence. But what is the impact, right? Impact meaning how is your technology, how will your results be used? How are you going to share the results? What about diversity, right? All of that is important. Very important to show that you have an excellent understanding of related work. You cannot go cold, because a program director will ask you when you are discussing your ideas, yeah, but then this sounds very similar to what so-and-so is doing. You need to be able to answer that question, right? Good to have, in a way, 2 to 3 topics, but not like 20 topics. Maybe one topic might not be sort of as advisable, because he or she, the program director, may say, no, that's not something we're interested in. Because recently I got one of my junior faculty in our institute talk to the Army. I told him, go with about 3 ideas. So he went with 3 ideas, and the program director liked one of them, not entirely. And he said, I like this, but you need to sort of adjust it a little bit. Listen to comments and suggestions. Discuss the type of program to apply. Type of program meaning, of course, if you're early in your career, a career proposal. Later on, you can do a large proposal, like in many programs, they got large, medium, small. When you are early in your career, you can go for a small proposal. There's also EAGR. These are sort of exploratory research ideas. I would also strongly advise, if you've got a really new idea, breakthrough idea, you want to do some exploration, EAGR would be good. And in many cases, I find it's good to interact with multiple program directors, because NSF, like at least in size, they've got this thing called theme, T-H-E-M-E, or clusters, right? So in one cluster could have 3 or 4 program directors. And so try and talk to all of them in a particular cluster, maybe. And then when you write proposals, especially large ones, you've got to form the right team, right? The members. So possibly interdisciplinary, right? If you are working in different areas, social science and cybersecurity, or cybersecurity and psychology. So, and also sometimes multi-institution. And it's always good not just go after the top universities. Maybe if you have a 4 institution, say UT Dallas, maybe another university which is sort of reasonably good, another university, say a minority institution maybe, and then a top-notch university. So that could be a great team to have. And pay attention to diversity and inclusion. I've noticed over the last year or two, diversity and inclusion have become really important, not just in proposals, but conferences. They've got women in cybersecurity, women in data science. There's also some interest on African Americans in cybersecurity. So diversity and inclusion is important. Okay, now, Department of Defense and intelligence agencies, I would say, while there are some similarities, there are also a lot of differences. Here, you've got to develop a good rapport, good relationship with the program director. Because NSF is a little bit different in the sense, although you've got to develop a rapport, but that close connection is not as critical as in the case of the Department of Defense and intelligence community. Because if they really feel that you are credible and you do good research, they will come to you. Okay, I need a proposal in this area. Could you please write one for me? Because I was observing, I was in a meeting, and one of the Air Force program directors was talking to this one particular PI, and he was, you know, of course, from a reasonably good university, but he's also done very good work. He said, oh, I need a proposal in this area. Can you submit something? But he didn't ask me, but he asked this other professor from another university. So you have to establish that trust, which is really important. Not only have excellent technical ideas, you have to do the homework about the mission of the agency, because they are not interested. I mean, they are interested in fundamental research, but it has to, because they've got to justify to their boss, right? Why is he funding or she funding this particular proposal? So you've got to understand the mission. So ideas must align closely with the interests of the agency. So if you are working with the DoD, then you've got to focus on how to help the warfighter, right? You can say, these ideas are going to help in this way. If you are working with the intelligence agencies like CIA, you have to make a convincing argument, say, how is it going to help the intelligence analyst? Because that's their mission. Work with the PD, program director, to elaborate on the research ideas. So he or she will say something, and then you want to look into that and say, okay, what about this, Dr. So-and-so? So work, you know, you've got to go back and forth. Not as much, that doesn't happen as much, I believe, with NSF. Make sure to follow up on the action items. And so continuing, there are also very large projects, right? Like MURI, Multidisciplinary University Research Initiative. Large projects up to $7.5 million. They like multiple universities to be involved. NSF also has large projects, but DoD is and the intelligence community, especially Department of Defense for MURI, it's somewhat unique because you can send your ideas to the program director, and it would be great if your ideas can go into the BAA, call for proposals or broad agency announcement, right? Because that way you can work right from the beginning. It doesn't mean that you are going to get funded. I have had my ideas go into the BAA, and a couple have gotten funded, and a couple have not gotten funded. I've got four ideas that went into BAA for the Department of Defense. Some one page I write and send it to the program directors. And so two of them, one was a MURI, one was another sort of medium-sized proposal, and two others, smaller proposals, they did not get funded. The MURI got funded, and then another idea also got funded. And then try your best, because you want your ideas to go into the call for proposals. And then you have to form the right team. So where my idea went in, and then I formed a team with five universities, I really wanted to head it. But I felt that that may not be the right move, in the sense that I had an NSF proposal where I got a comment, myself and another lady, she had come from Europe and she was in US, and some others, they said both PIs, right, have not been in US academia long. So I felt that there was a different proposal from NSF, because she came from Europe, I came from industry and MITRE Corporation, and so I felt that, you know, I didn't want that to be a negative point. So I got actually someone else to lead that MURI. It would have been really great for UTD to have led that MURI, but I felt it's better for us to get the MURI and we got some $1+ million than us lose the MURI, okay? So right team with the right expertise, possibly interdisciplinary multi-institution for MURIs, more or less you have to for large proposals, have continuous close interactions with the program director by discussing new ideas and challenges. And I think this is like my last chart. I would say never give up. It's easy to get discouraged if your proposals are rejected. Remember, I came to UT Dallas fall October 2004. And remember, I didn't come from academia. So I came from a federal research lab where I had lots of funding, but that is not highly competitive funding. When you come into academia, it's extremely competitive. And so it took me 11 months to get my first grant. And UT Dallas was getting a little bit impatient because, oh, they expected, just because I come from NSF, of course I can't go to NSF and talk to them for 1 year. So, and then I hadn't gotten any grants. So it took me 1 year to get that $300K first grant. And now our institute has gotten about $65 million in this last 16 years, not just me. I mean, we've got some very, very good faculty that we hired. So all of them collectively, we have done really well. However, you have to write about 10 good proposals to get one funded, not just 10, any proposals. Try not to get an uncompetitive or non-competitive results. So do your best. And if you do your best, rarely will it be non-competitive. Almost all my proposals I've written, except maybe about 2%, 1 or 2%, have always been competitive, low competitive, competitive, high competitive, right? But 1 out of 10 is what, on average, when you start out. Now I would say I get more like 2 or 20 to 30% funded. So never get discouraged. Get your proposals reviewed by trusted colleagues. So especially if you're junior, go to your senior faculty, even your peers, but you have to trust them because you don't want other people to steal your ideas, right? And that sometimes happens. And one thing I didn't like is when programs, PIs keep calling you every day. Don't pester them, right? They have lots of work to do. So be very strategic, you know, but you have to persist. So it's a sort of a balance, you know, you can't just call and talk to them every day. So there has to be a balance and you have to, I mean, I can't say exactly how it's going to work for you, but over the years, sort of, I've developed my own way of dealing with things. And one thing is really important, I learned this from MITRE Corporation, our CEO will always say, show that you are making progress and report results, right? You've got to make sure, once you get the money, don't just go and, you know, do whatever you want. You have to show results. And what is really important, make your program director look good. That's what our CEO at MITRE used to always say, make your customer look good. Customer is the one who gives you money. So what do we mean? That means make him look good to his bosses. That means you've got to produce good results, right? So that he can then show. So when I was telling like my colleagues in front of my program director, okay, you have to make Dr. So-and-so look good. So he was joking and say, oh, you mean I don't look good now? So, but anyway, but he understood what I was trying to say, right? You have to make him look good to his boss. That means you have to produce. Dr. Roteo said, continue to publish in top tier venues in your field. For us, it's top tier conferences in computer science, but almost every other field, it's top tier journals, okay? In time, it will all come together for you, right? I've been working for 40 years, right? Well, I started when I was 25, soon after my PhD. So I've been working for 40 years in, first I was visiting faculty, commercial industry for me, because my son was a baby. So I was in visiting faculty for 3 years and then 6+ years in commercial industry. I was at Honeywell, 13 years at MITRE Corporation. Then I had a 3-year IPA and then 16 years at UT Dallas. And finally for me, you have to be patient. It's all coming together, you know, getting these awards and various other things. So you've got to be motivated. You have to be patient. You've got to never, ever give up, right? Those are the things I want to leave you with, the key points.
Excellent. Thank you, Dr. Bhavani. We do have a couple of questions to discuss. And question, would you suggest prospective applicants email a white paper and then ask for a phone call to discuss?
No, I think sending email without knowing who is the recipient and what's the style is not something I advise. Some program directors will ask for that, but first you need to know what do they prefer.
I agree with Dr. Roteo fully on this, because out of the blue, you get an email, you don't have no idea who this person is, and you get, you know, hundreds of emails if you're a program director. So it's always good to have that initial sort of connection, initially maybe through email you've got to, or see when you see him or her in a conference, you know, so that he knows you, right? So send an email introducing yourself, so that there is some connection, then send the abstract. That's how I would approach.
Okay, very interesting. How do you, or do you, believe that being a reviewer is an advantage, and specifically, how does this work to your advantage?
Okay, so yes, reviewer helps a lot because you know how the other reviewer, how a panel works at NSF, right? DoD is a little bit different because you know, you don't review as many proposals, but NSF especially, you know how a panel works, who know how some panelists react, who know you can gauge how some panelists try to push some proposals. Some other panelists may say, oh, this is a bad proposal. You know, you can sort of see the games that are being played, the good things and the not so good things, so you know what your proposal is going to go through. So it's always good to have that idea. I mean, to have a good idea what's going to happen. So I would strongly encourage for you to participate in a panel before you submit a proposal. What do you think, Dr. Rotea?
Oh, I agree. Being a reviewer is very helpful to become known to the program director. So then the issue is you're going to do a service, and that's what the review is for. So that's the job. And then what side effects will this have for you? That is that's the key. Use a meeting to have the program director see that you know what you're talking about. Some young reviewers fall on the trap of speaking too much or saying nothing. Finding the right balance is critical. It's not about good and bad proposals. Leave that to the more senior people that sometimes they just want to articulate what's good and bad for everybody. But it's about strengths and weaknesses. So you do a review, you say this is good about this proposal, this is strength of this proposal, this is a weakness of this proposal. Always articulate everything from the perspective of a reference. It's not about your opinion. It's about what is being written in the proposal and how you articulate your analysis, your grade that you will give to that proposal based on what is known and available to others so that people can verify what you're saying. I think the best way to get in a panel is through a senior faculty member. If you approach a PD and they don't know you, to develop that level of comfort to invite you to a panel is going to take several emails. And I don't think that's very productive. I personally have nominated people for serving in panels in the areas that I know, because I cannot nominate someone outside an area I don't, someone in an area I don't know. But this to me is the most effective way. So try to find colleagues that are like-minded colleagues, senior to you, who have been through this route, who are familiar with the program directors, and say, hey, would you nominate me for serving in a panel, and do that. That I advise strongly. It's not a good idea to tell a PD directly, if they don't know you, I want to serve in one of your panels.
Mm-hmm. Yes, those are excellent ideas for getting in front of them, but politely and respectfully and not pushing. So thank you both. Do you recommend calling a program officer to ask for feedback once you get a decline?
Yeah, okay, so you receive your review. The first thing you do is just, let me take this back. The objective of a submission, and I tell this to all colleagues, of course, is to get funded. But if you don't get funded, the next prize is to receive a good review. Mm-hmm. That's the key. The proposal is, you think this proposal should get a good review, even if it doesn't get the money. So now you get your reviews back, and the review is good, but you didn't get funding. What do you do? You just wait until the next turn because the review is good, and you know, why insist? There may be a constraint on budget or topic, who knows? The alternative is the reviews are not good. You don't agree, and that's your first gut reaction. So what I think you should do, this is what I believe has worked for me, you put the reviews in a drawer. And you don't touch them until you have cool off and come back and read them. And once you understand that, you can go back to the program director and say, hey, I got the reviews, I read them. There are some points that I see and some points that I don't quite see. Do you mind explaining that to me? That's their job, and they should do it.
So I'd like to add a little bit. I agree fully. And I think, yes, it's important not to react immediately. You get angry, you get frustrated. So the reviews are not good. You know, you want to talk, you know, why, what do you think, how can I improve? And then you might want to also give some suggestions, you know, what you think. And then if the reviews are good and you didn't get funding, I still think it'll be good to find out, you know. So of course, then they will say, but you know, there's so much fun. Typically the response we get, there's only so much money. And there were some very good proposals that we didn't fund, some that did even better than yours, but at least let them say.
Thank you for both of those perspectives. I do not see any more questions in the chat. So I'll give each of you one last option to wrap anything up for comments or anything you want to follow up on.
I think I talked about my final thoughts, right? Never give up. And as Dr. Rotaria and I, we have both said, you want the proposal to have good reviews, regardless of whether it's going to get funded or not. Of course, you want it to get funded, but that's sometimes beyond your control. At least if they are good reviews, there might be some possibility. Later on, it just happened to me. My program director has found some money and he or she has given me some funding later on. So if the proposal is good, there's always that possibility. And then you have to really get the proposals reviewed by trusted colleagues. That's another thing. And again, the main thing is to continue to work hard, get yourself established, get yourself known, and never ever give up. Those are my sort of final words.
I want to reinforce what you just said, Bhavani, because this actually happens. If you have good reviews, and let's say you're recommended but not highly recommended and you didn't get funding, then the end of the year comes and there is always some pot of money that has not been used and someone wants to use. So that could be the opening door to get funding. The other thing I wanted to add is this issue of meeting program directors. Now we are in this COVID era where everything is like we're doing it today, right? Online, people are in different locations, maybe different time zones. Go to the professional conferences and sign up for these one-on-one with program directors. They are very good. And the program directors care. I think that's my advice. Don't miss that. That's a good opportunity. That and the senior colleague to introduce you to a program director for a panel, I think are the main things I wanted to stress.
Excellent. Well, thank you both, Dr. Rotaria and Dr. Theresingham and Emily, for sharing the Insight Scoop with us and your lessons learned. Audience, thank you for attending today.